order. I'm going to call the meeting, the special meeting of the Windsor Board of Education of Tuesday, October 4th, to order. If we could please stand for the pledge to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. We can remain standing for a moment of silence. Thank you. Tonight's meeting is being carried live on Win TV, being broadcasted on the educational channel 95. It will also be recorded and played on channel 95. We want to thank Win TV for being here this evening and help taping and carry live for us. I also want to make note that Vice President Mr. Leonard Lockhart finds himself stuck in the way back from Vermont. I hope he can actually make it down for part of the presentation. He says his apologies for not being here, but hopefully we will still be graced by his presence sometime this evening. At this time, I'm going to move on to agenda item number 2, audience to visitors. Seeing none, we'll go right on to the presentation on our district accountability report, and I'll turn it over to Dr. Craig Cook.
Thank you, President Santos and Board of Education. We're happy to be here tonight to present you with two exciting presentations, we believe. They're very comprehensive, and we're going to move through a lot of information, but we're here to answer any questions as well. With me is Santasha Oliver, our Assistant Superintendent for Instruction, and also with us tonight are our principals, cabinet, and our directors of STEM and humanities. And so they'll be jumping in if there's any questions we're unable to answer or anything at the end of the presentations that you might have directly for the buildings or the other folks here that will be able to handle that. So the first part of tonight is really going over our next generation accountability report from the state of Connecticut. And we had hoped when we set up this schedule in the summer that we'd have the 2015-2016 report from the state. We do not. We were told we'd have that recently by the state by the end of 2016. So as soon as we have that report for the district from last school year, we would provide that to the board. However, it's really important that we set the stage on what the next generation accountability report will look like and what it measures as we move into budget time and as the board goes into goal setting specifically. So I will just spend a brief amount of time really on this portion of the report. The second portion of tonight is going to go into our results as a district from 2015-2016. So really the information that Santasha will be presenting to you is the information that is then used to fill in the report that I'm going to share with you. So this is really the template. Santasha is going to present the results from this past school year, 2015-2016. So I will start with what our new system is intended to do. Really what we are looking at here is tracking progress for us as a district, helping schools and districts make improvements, show where support is needed most as a school district, recognize successes and promote transparency and satisfy federal and state requirements. And so really when the Every Student Succeeds Act was approved by the federal government and the president, that there was a move away from just measuring, you know, our traditional measures that were on that were CMT and CAPT, but now include SBAC and SAT. And really looking at a fuller look of our students in our school system. And so we were very supportive of this. I know we spoke to the board in this in the past that we were welcoming these changes and excited about these changes because in Windsor, and as the board knows through their work on their own 9 goals and their mission statement, we're looking much farther beyond just the CMT, SBAC, and CAPT, and SAT. And so, you know, in some ways the board was ahead of the curve in terms of that work because the board's goals were much more encompassing and I think really do align quite nicely to what the indicators are going to be as part of this state report. Why were the changes made? As I mentioned, ESSA was a big part of that work, and you know, measuring more fully what school districts are doing. There were districts, and I think you're aware of some yourself, that really did focus on just tested areas, and Windsor never went into that, never went down that path. So we've always had a very comprehensive school system. This does, you know, we feel provide a more complete picture of the school district. It does guard, as I mentioned, narrowing the focus. One of the great pieces that I've seen is that it does expand the ownership of accountability to all staff, and we've really seen this as we talk to staff in the buildings, as we develop our new district data team that is much broader scope of employees that are in there. We do have teachers on the committee, and we're seeing teachers from areas such as physical education and career and technical ed be part of that group and really be part of that discussion and that improvement. It does measure growth, which as well is something we've always shared here in Windsor when we've shared results with you, and tonight will be no different, that we focus on growth of our students. And actually, this measure rewards growth more than just the test itself, the test results itself. So that's really exciting for us as we go forward. The reports, what they will look like is there'll be a district report and then one for each school building. The district report, and as you go through, and I'll indicate that on the different indicators as we go through, the district report is a full report, and the high school itself is a full report. Everything is measured, but as you go to other grade levels, as you imagine, there are things that are not measured at the middle school and our elementary schools, such as post-secondary entrance. You know, they don't have data on that, or four-year graduation rate is not part of the measure for our elementary schools or middle school. I'm going to just briefly go through this slide because the 17 indicators on here, there is a slide for each of those and explains how that's measured and calculated. But as I mentioned, it's a much broader look at the school district, and there's actually 17 different indicators that you have in front of you in the PowerPoint, and that's up on the screen. And then I'll go through each one of those as well as we go through. That's really the bulk of the presentation. So what are those 17 indicators? The first and what makes up the bulk of the report is our three subject areas that are tested, our English, language, arts, math, and science indicators. And what they measure those for are for all students receive a result in those areas, and then students in high needs subgroup also receive a result. And as the board knows, high needs is special education, free and reduced lunch students, and ELL students. So those students make up a subgroup, and the district receives a measure on that from each of those subgroups. So for instance, there is English language arts result in third grade for all students, and there's an English language arts result for students in high needs in third grade as well. There's a math all students, math students in high needs subgroup for third grade. And so it there's multiple measures within those indicators that that make up those results. And again, you know, when you see the report, this will be very helpful, but it also, I think, as I mentioned, helps the board set their goals and also the, you know, for the budget process itself. Math and science follow the same path, except that science, as you know, is just tested in 5th, 8th, and 10th grade. The academic growth, as I mentioned, is a major part of this results. And so what they look at is individual students moving through the grades and the success that they've had. So a student in third grade that takes a test on a SBAC 1-4 measure, if that student moves from a 2 to a 3, the district is rewarded really twice for that, because the student has now moved to the third level, which is considered goal, and then we're also given credit for moving that student. So that growth potential, which again, Dr. Oliver is going to cover, you know, during her presentation, is so important, and that's what we look at as we look at as a district. We look at each individual student, and we're trying to move him or her, you know, through that through those result measures. There's also the academic growth for our students in high needs subgroup. you know, now we start to get to other areas that were not measured on a state report or a district report card before, but now become a very important part of the assessment here. And so as we look at chronic absenteeism indicator, there's a percentage for students chronically absent, all students, and then also for the students in high need subgroups. So as you may remember, I know I shared it with the entire board, the convocation presentation, and we are doing a lot of work as a district on student absenteeism. We find that our student attendance is very strong at the elementary level, and really through the middle school, it's pretty good. But then we start to have some concerns at the high school level, where we're addressing. But we want to make sure that those numbers are lower, and we're addressing that for each area. And so I know that print school buildings are now in the time that they're sharing information with families about individual students' attendance already, so that's much sooner than we would have. Usually that would be at the first marking period, but we're already in the process of doing that, because we know the sooner we do that, get that information into families' hands, the sooner we can, you know, start to work on improving that. Mr. Carvalho and his team worked very closely with that high need subgroup and in addressing chronic absenteeism as well across the district. Next area is preparation for post-secondary and career readiness coursework. And so this is the state looking at the percentage of students in grades 11 and 12 participating in at least one of the following during their high school career. So two courses in AP. IB is International Baccalaureate. We do not have that at the high school, but I wanted to give the board all the measures, or two courses in one of seven career and technical ed categories, or workplace experience courses. So as the board knows, we have a very rich career and technical ed program and a rich and expansive advanced placement, really, for us to improve in this area. It's about getting students to take that second course, making sure there's access for career and technical ed. That had been an area that we've had to make some reductions in over the years, but we turn students away from those areas each and every year because of the popularity of those courses. So we're looking at potentially expanding those. That's the work that I've asked Mr. Asunde to look at this year and work with school counseling, and so they're very much, you know, on top of that area. Another example for dual enrollment would be the UConn Early College Experience Program. We have eight courses at the high school that meet that. So, you know, there's an opportunity you could take an AP course and an Early College Experience course, and so that would meet that indicator. So, again, I find this to be something that will reward the comprehensive nature of Windsor High School and all the programs and courses we have up there. Next is preparation for post-secondary and career readiness based on exams. So it's in this area, it's not just taking the course, but it's how you do on the exam, you know, going into college. So it's passing those exams. Smarter Balance is going backwards, but going forwards, SAT, ACT, Advanced Placement, and IB is one area. So it's looking at the percentage of our students that meet the benchmark for SAT, and AP is really our predominant measures in those areas. If you had a student that did not meet that measure in SAT or AP, then ACT could be used as well. We had about 30 students last year take ACT at the high school. Next indicator is graduation and on track in ninth grade. So I know we've spoken to the board about this in the past, that if we know a student is finishing ninth grade on track for graduation, that's a very good thing. That's a measure we're looking at very closely. And so this is the percentage of ninth graders earning at least five full year credits in the year and no more than one failing grade in English, math, science, or social studies. So this is an area where we're rewarded for having block scheduling, because as you know, students could have up to eight credits as a freshman. Typically, our students are taking seven and having one study hall. But you could have a student taking seven credits, you know, unfortunately maybe failing one course, but still meeting this mark because they're earning five credits going forward. I know, again, this is an area that the high school has put a lot of resources into for this year. Mr. Sunday and Carol Schultz are working directly with the ninth grade that they are putting a lot of resources into that, as I mentioned, and we try and keep our class sizes as low as possible in the ninth grade and support students coming over from Sage Park as they come into Windsor High School. Next indicator is graduation four-year adjusted cohort for basically our graduation rate for all students. And so what the state does is look at the percentage of first-time ninth graders who graduate with a regular high school diploma in 4 years or less. These are this is a measure for all students. And so to max out on this indicator, you have to have 94% graduating in that four-year rate. Windsor High School's in 2014-15. We don't have 15-16 yet, but in 14-15 it was 92.5%. So we'd be pretty close to the maximum amount for that rating. This is again something we've been working on pretty consistently. I know we've presented this data to the board in the past, where we were in the 80s, not that long ago, and have creeped up about a percentage point or a point and a half each of the last 3 or 4 years. So we're hoping to continue that growth as we move forward and reach that 94%. There's no high needs measure for a four-year. There is for a six-year adjusted cohort. So the state looks back how many of those students in those high needs group graduate within 6 years of starting high school. And so that again is looking at special ed free and reduced lunch in ELL, and looking at the percentage of students that graduate in 6 years. Our rate on that is typically in the high 90s, as you would imagine. And so we expect that we'll max out on that. There's not a specific target from the state, but we expect to do very well in that measure. Post-secondary entrance rate, all students. So this is the percentage of the graduating class who enroll in a 2 or 4 year post-secondary institution anytime during the first year after high school graduation. So we know that about 90% of our students at Windsor High School are accepted and planning to go into a 4 or 2 year school when they graduate. We know that percentage, as do all districts, drops off slightly before you get to the fall, but it does recognize if that student then goes in the second semester. 75% is the target for this measure, and Windsor High School's always been above that target, so we would expect to get full rating on that post-secondary entrance rate. Next area is physical fitness. So the board has had a goal on health and wellness, and one of the ways we've measured that goal and tied that to our work is physical fitness. So I'm excited that again we were ahead of looking at data in this area. And so what they look at is the percentage of students meeting or exceeding the health fitness zone standard in all four areas of the physical fitness assessment. And so they also look at participation, because you need to have above a 90% in participation in order to get full credit for students passing. We've always had above 90%, but I think that's a good measure that they make sure you maintain that 90%. I will tell you, in our 3 through 5 schools have been a real leader in this. We've looked at that data for quite some time. As I've said, I would expect that they'd be pretty close to maxing out those results. They're ahead of many other districts when we look at them. I would say a leader in the state in terms of their methods for tracking data and working with students and increasing those results. We do have a dip in middle school and high school, and so we've been addressing that and looking at that. Some of it is related to our curriculum, and so for instance, we teach swimming in 10th grade, and the physical fitness test is also in 10th grade. And swimming's certainly very important in cardiovascularly and things like that, but it may not be leading towards students passing that assessment. So we're looking at that and when we teach swimming at the high school. Also, the state has provided some guidance and some flexibility on when we give the test. So We know sometimes we're giving the test first thing in the morning or you know, during the school day that some students have concerns with that or don't necessarily do their best. So now we have an opportunity to give the test outside of the school day, so we can give the, we actually could give the test after school and have the students ride the late bus home or you know, go to their athletic practice or things like that. So there's really some good flexibility coming from the state that it does not necessarily just need to be during the PE class period, and we believe that will be one of the ways we can raise our results in that area. Another area, I think Windsor's been ahead of the curve too, is art access. So we have a great art program, really K through 12, but you know, our 9 through 12 art program is very well recognized and has, you know, many opportunities for students. And so this is measuring the percentage of students in grades 9 through 12 who participate in at least one dance, theater, music, or visual arts course. And so we have you know, a wide range of courses. I think where we will maybe not max out is we have many students go on and take 4 or 5 courses in these areas, but then we'll have some students not take any courses in these areas. So we're looking at designing courses such as a dance course that would appeal to a wider range of students and would increase the enrollment in those areas. So if you look at a pottery course at the high school, there's a small number of students that might be in that, 18 to 20, but you could look at a one teacher teaching 5 periods of dance that may be able to, you know, teach 140 students or so throughout their course load. So there's some real opportunities there, you know, and we're looking at how things are coded. You know, we have that stagecraft course and things like that, so they we're making sure they line up with one of those areas through the state guidelines. So it is something that we would look to expand opportunities through new courses, new curriculums as we go forward. So again, I wish I had a result chart for you, but we don't have some of the indicators from the state. We have most of them, and they're in the process now of calculating that. I do think the state did a very good job of getting feedback from districts as they developed this report. They didn't take all our feedback and institute it into the report, but they did, you know, have several focus groups and conversations with superintendents and administrators and teachers in terms of what should be measured. And they have a rather lengthy guidebook that goes along with that, which is really what I presented to you tonight, was a summary of that information. And I think as well, this information will be clearer once you hear from Dr. Oliver in terms of the results that we do have in hand, and we'll provide results as they come in. So I expect graduation rate within a few weeks. We typically receive that in October, and that's something we're always proud to share with the board and as we receive the other results. But certainly when we receive that you know, full report, we'd be sharing that with the board, and I imagine coming back and presenting that to you at a board meeting or a special meeting. That will really be the measure. There's a ultimate number that's assigned to the district. That'll be the measure to determine whether we remain an Alliance district, whether we've moved out of that area, where we rank within the state, and where future supports come in or plans that must be written with the state and how focused, you know, schools are determined and things such as that. So this is really, you know, the focus of our data work as we go forward. Now I know we went through that relatively quickly. Any questions on that while we transition to Dr. Oliver?
So before Dr. Oliver presents her portion, which is more numbers, are there any questions on the general overview right now on Dr. Cook's presentation?
Thank you. You probably can't answer this, but do you have any estimate of when we would have the full report from the state?
I was told by the end of the calendar year, 2016.
Okay. And the it's anticipated then that would be an annual?
Yes. I would hope that they move that up, because when you receive something from the previous year in December or even November, we've already determined staffing and placements and things like that. So we're in that mode of always really being a year behind. I mean, you think about it, if we get it in December, we're already, you know, pretty much through our internal budget process, you know, right, in terms of requesting staff or coursework or, you know, as you know, curriculum takes about a year, you know, to get it written and fully approved, and or even more in some cases. So, you know, we're constantly, you know, playing catch up with that. So I would hope we get to the point where we're receiving it over the summer, but we're not there yet.
Do you know, and again, I don't know if you can answer this, but in terms of the format that this is provided, is this going to be something that's publicly available? I know that several years ago there was, you know, the state made, you could pull up, you know, by school district and even, I think, by building. There were some statistics that were available. Is that the idea here as well, that it would be available to the general public?
Yes, and that you'd be able to compare district to district, school to school. Yes.
Okay. And last question. You just mentioned Alliance District status. Is I know that there's been a lot of talk about that and whether or not it's going to that's going to continue, if that's still going to be a designation that we're using. So is that, are you implying that that is then going to continue and that the state's going to still sort of use that as a designation, or?
I don't know. Okay. You know, what we've lobbied for, and we're talking to our politicians as well as the state, is that the funding that's allowed us as a district, I believe, to move out of Alliance status. I believe if you look at our results and you compare them, you know, with the 30 districts that were in the Alliance, that we would have moved beyond that and be not one of the 30 lowest. But certainly that, you know, it was 928,000, now 769,000. That's been part of the driver to move us out of that. So. And I have spoken to politicians as well as the state to say that Windsor should continue to receive that funding no matter what our designation is. You know, for it would be really the end of the 5 years is at the end of this year, and so it'd be next school year, you know, when they recalculate that, where we would stand. That my hope would be that in one form or another, Windsor continues to receive that. So I think at the very least that should go to the town of Windsor, and that through an ECS funding, but I think there's still a potential it could come directly to the school district.
Okay, yeah, just curious, because it seems like if, you know, there is a new accountability model and a framework and a new, you know, tool to assess all of that, that there would also be, you know, some direction to the district as to, you know, and districts throughout the state as to how that's going to affect this designation. Is it still 30 districts? Sure. Are the criteria different? So hopefully we'll get some more information on that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Mr. Arata?
Yes, thank you. I know this is the first year coming up, 2017, when community service is a requirement for graduation. Does that apply to all subgroups? And I'm sure we're going to be tracking that, make sure that most students are not aware.
Yeah, so it applies to any student that would be receiving a high school diploma, so it applies to all students within the high school, and they do have a pretty comprehensive system of tracking that through Mr. Bianchi and school counseling, and so they're meeting with students that might be needing hours and giving them opportunities and things like that. We've met basically students where they are at, or what, you know, what their interests or capabilities were to be able to make sure they get those 20 hours.
Any other questions on this initial report? Mr. Panos?
Dr. Cook, with regard to the graduation rate, is there any consideration of the number of students who achieve the target largely due to the use of credit recovery?
No.
Is there,
so
there's
any,
no measure of that, no intent?
Okay.
I just say that because in Judge Mukasher's ruling, he made a point of that, so I didn't know whether that would have any bearing on this. Let's see. So we don't, in these measures, do you have several of these measures that you're going to present, Dr. Oliver is going to present here already? I mean, much of this data comes from us, so presumably we would have this data now. I mean, I can understand that we have SAT data.
Right, so that's part of Dr. Oliver's presentation,
the
big academic.
Yeah, I understand.
But
the rest of these, chronic absenteeism indicator, preparation, I mean, all that is self-generated. All they're doing to it is collating it for all districts. So. Graduation on track. I mean, we don't have this available to us now. It seems that most of this data would have been something that we provided to the state.
Right, we're looking at our data. It's not official till we get it from the state, but we do look at our data as we go through. I mean, we have a pretty good idea, obviously, of the number of ninth graders who moved on to 10th grade, you know, in terms of our measure, but, you know, some of them may have, you know, potentially more than they might have taken 8 courses and failed 2, and then they have 6, they're moving on, so that they're not going to meet this standard.
But that would be information that you would have already.
Yep. Right. Yeah, we have, you know, as I mentioned, the physical fitness exam, the art access, we know, you know, how many of our students are doing the art classes, but in terms of the official state measure, you know, we're waiting for that. We can't necessarily calculate our own graduation rates in either of those. That's one area where we really can't calculate our own graduation, because they take into account, so if a ninth grader did 2 years in Windsor and left and went to another district in Connecticut, that student's not counted against us. That student left and there's no connection.
But that's counted to us?
It's not attributed to us, no, but it doesn't count against us. But if a student leaves and if a student left over the summer, did not request their transcripts to go anywhere, we cannot share where they have gone, that does count against us.
But that would be a small number.
Correct.
With regard to post-secondary entrance rate, percentage of graduating class enrolled in 2 or 4 year, what is I don't quite understand the value of this. I mean, if you said 4 year, it would have a bit more meaning here. So the 2 year, I mean, most 2 year schools, I mean, I understand that some people go to 2 year and then they go to the 4 year, and however, to get into most 2 year colleges or community colleges requires, you know, not much, you know, don't even require SATs for the most part. It could be remedial, it could be a number of things. I'm just surprised that this is a state, this is what the state says, is it? And they don't, and there's no consideration, for example, if someone got accepted into a military, I mean, after all, they have standards. You can't just walk into the military, you know, or some vocational schools can be so that is not considered here.
I think the part of the reason why they set the target at 75% is they understand a certain percentage of students are going into the military directly, not a military school. I would imagine that, you know.
No, but well, despite that, I mean, when you get into the military, you will correct. Select a school. If you choose a vocational, there is normally some, you know, helicopter repair or something like this. You don't. It's not anybody that's just going to get in.
No, I understand. But I will tell you, some of our financially savvy students, or some of our most financially savvy students, are going into 2 year colleges through the state agreement. You do 2 years at MCC or Esnuntuk, you get the grade level that you need to, and you go right into UConn or Central, and you come out with a 4 year degree that sits alongside any other student that did 4 years.
I understand, but there are, you know, to get into Esnuntuk, or, you know, it's not like getting into University of Hartford, let's put it that way. And to get into the University of Hartford, you have to meet certain standards. And I understand that in order to save money, and it's a good idea, they do have courses and all like that. However, due to this, and it's a very good, very valuable system, but on the other hand, it also includes a lot of students who go there for remedial reasons and this stuff. So I don't quite understand the inclusion of it here. It's kind of, yeah, but that's all they have right here. There's just a 2 and 4. That's
right.
Okay.
What's that? Any other questions? Ms. Pissel?
So these are the points of the state. Is there any, do you have any discussion about strengthening the indicators or adding additional indicators? Because, like, if you're going to handle report to the board, that we might want additional information. For example, I agree that using like 2 year, 4 year enrollment in post-secondary education isn't necessarily like the best indication of post-secondary career or college readiness. And the reason why is because, as we know, within the state, a lot of students are graduating from high school and entering into remedial courses in college, and this is an expressed concern. And so I understand once they graduate from Windsor High School, they're not necessarily our responsibility anymore. But I do believe that including additional indicators that follow the student would be helpful to determine whether or not our curriculum, whatever programming, whether or not we're allocating resources in the right way, et cetera. So has there been any discussion about including additional indicators that lead for reporting to the board?
So I think we would continue to report on things we have. This expands the accountability measures that we typically report to the board. So where we're above as a target, then when I work with principals on their school improvement plan, we're setting goals that are above that. So just to share a little bit of information, what we've had, what Dr. Oliver and I have asked principals to do, and we're meeting with them, and they're still getting some of their data in, is when they develop their school improvement plan, they have their typical school improvement plan, but then they address each of the indicators in here. And so, where we're above those as a target, we're setting higher targets, and staying above that, because, the state at some point could raise those targets there. Ultimately, it's always our goal that students leave Windsor High School and do not have to take remedial courses in college. But we do know that is happening. So that's something that we're working on addressing. I think SAT scores is a good way to look at that, and how our students are prepared for college. And they've tied the new SAT to reaching a certain level as a predictor of getting a B in math in college. And so, that those students that do well in the SAT will do well on their college entrance exam and not have to take those courses.
All right, so thank you, Dr. Cook. Pass it off to Dr. Oliver.
I'm going
to
change the PowerPoint.
Mentioned the second portion of this evening's presentation will focus on the 2016 state assessment results. So the Connecticut Summative Assessment System includes the Connecticut Smarter Balanced Assessment, which is taken grades 3-8, as well as the Connecticut Mastery Test, which assesses science in grades 5, 8, and 10. As well as the Connecticut Academic Performance Test, which assesses science in grade 10, and the SAT School Day, which is now taken in grade 8. So while the objective of this evening's presentation will be to present the results of these statewide assessments, it should be noted that these summative assessments are intended to provide an annual snapshot of student achievement that should be used cautiously along with other metrics, such as classwork, class tests, looking at student work when making educational decisions. And so when considering this evening's state assessment data, it's important to note that students have advanced one grade level since the last administration in spring 2016, which is highlighted here on the slide. And so this slide provides a scope and sequence of this evening's data presentation. So I will divide the assessment results into three segments, beginning with the 2016 CMT and CAPT science results. So as Dr. Cook mentioned, science is assessed statewide in grades 5, 8, and 10. The CMT and CAPT science assessments are based on the Connecticut Core Science Curriculum Framework, which was adopted in 2004. This framework articulates the concepts and skills that students are expected to know and be able to do. And so there is an overall science score that's reported out on the CMT, along with subscores in life science, physical science, earth science, as well as scientific inquiry, literacy, and numeracy. And similarly in CAT, there's an overall science score reported with subscores in each of the content strands, such as energy transformations, chemical structures and properties, global interdependence, cell chemistry, biotechnology, genetics, evolution, biodiversity, as well as scientific inquiry, literacy, and numeracy. And so for the standard CMT and CAT, there are 5 performance levels. And so student scores will fall into one of these performance levels, ranging from below basic to advanced. And as Dr. Cook previously mentioned, while federal goals have traditionally focused on the percentage of students at or above the proficient level, here in Windsor, we will continue to focus on the percentage of students scoring at or above the goal level. And so it's important to consider the performance of students at or above the goal level, as proficiency is simply a way station along the road toward goal and advanced performance. It's also important to note that the CMT and CAT performance levels that will be shared this evening do not have any relationship with the Smarter Balanced Assessment. And so this evening, it should also be noted that both performance at and above proficiency, as well as at and above goal, we presented for science. And so moving on to science performance in grade 5, we see from 2015 to 2016, the percentage of students scoring at or above the goal level increased by 1 percentage point. I'd also like to note that here we see performance at or above proficiency and at or above goal shown here in red and gray, respectively. Here we are looking at overall science performance in grade 8, and so the percentage of students at or above goal decreased by 11 percentage points from 2015 to 2016. The overall performance of students in grade 10, we have the percentage of students at or above goal remain unchanged from 2015 to 2016. And so as mentioned, these assessments are, science assessments are administered in grades 5, 8, and 10. And as such, the year-to-year results reflect the performance of different groups of students. And so here you see a 5-year trend of the science performance in grade 5. And so we do know a decrease of 7 percentage points from the 2012 to 2016 administration. Again, the year-to-year results over the last 5 years reflects performance of different groups of students. So here we have performance in grade 8 over the last 5 years. And so we see that performance has trended down. But again, these are different groups of students. And conversely, in grade 10, again, we're looking at student performance. So again, different groups of students. However, student performance in grade 10 has trended upward over the last 5 years. And so I'd also like to note this is also a statistically significant increase noted from the 2012 to 2016 administration. And so generally speaking, the 2016 CMT and CAP science results were mixed. In November of 2015, the Connecticut State Board of Education adopted the Next Generation Science Standards. And so these new science standards will serve as the basis for future science assessments. And as such, we will continue to provide professional development with respect to the new standards, revise curriculum, and also look at instructional practices. And so in the next segment of the presentation, I'd like to share the 2016 Smarter Balanced Assessment results in mathematics and English language arts. And so it should be noted that this assessment is aligned to the Connecticut core standards for English language arts and mathematics. It's also administered at the end of school in grades 3 through 8. This annual summative assessment was designed as a global measure of student learning and it measures students in, student learning in two ways. There's a computer adaptive component, as well as a performance task component in mathematics. And so the computer adaptive test is based on student responses, and so the computer program will adjust the difficulty of the questions throughout the assessment. The computer adaptive test also contains a variety of item types. And then there is a computer adaptive test in both English language arts and mathematics. As stated, there's also performance tasks in mathematics, and so the performance tasks are activities that measure students' ability to apply knowledge and skills to a complex task, measure depth of understanding, research skills, and the ability to analyze information. And so for the Smarter Balanced Assessment, there are four performance levels, and students' scores will fall into one of these four performance levels, ranging from level one, which is the lowest, to level four, which is the highest. And again, the Smarter Balanced levels have no relationship to the CMT and CAP levels. And again, here in Windsor, level three is our goal, so this evening results will be presented at level three or higher. And so shown here, we have the overall mathematics performance in grades 3 through 8 from 2015, shown in red, to 2016, shown in gray. Another way to look at this information is in a table. And so again, here we're also depicting the difference of student performance from 2015 to 2016. I'd like to point out that there were statistically significant differences observed in both grades 4 and grade 7, with 6 percentage point increases in grade 7, and in grade 4, and a very large percentage gain in grade 7 of 22 percentage points. And so when we look at the overall data and we average the data across grades, that's grades 3 through 8, we saw an overall gain of over 4 percentage points from 2015 to 2016. And as Dr. Cook mentioned, it should also be noted that our performance was among the top in the Alliance cohort. And so the year-to-year SBAT data presented here reflects the performance changes of different groups of students. And so while looking at data in this manner is standard practice, I'd like to caution the board and the audience that changes in scores from year to year, so for example, from 2015 to 2016, reflect changes in student demographics, ability, because again, we're highlighting different groups of students. And so the examination of match students or even non-match students progressing through grades and Windsor over time is really the gold standard in terms of analyzing student growth. And so it should be noted that when we looked at student growth or non-matched cohorts, we certainly saw that students were progressing from grade to grade across grades. So for example, we would might note that we had a fourth grader in 2016, that outperformed his or her results as a third grader in 2015. So again, looking at how students are progressing as they move from one grade to the next. And again, that growth was observed across all grade bands with the exception of the grade 7 to grade 8 change. And we did see a slight decrease there. However, this overall information is very powerful because it shows growth of students and it really allows us to understand if we're moving students from wherever they begin. I'd also like to note that student growth in grade 5 here in Windsor actually outperformed or exceeded growth of the state. So that's also another thing to highlight, the fact that the growth here in Windsor outperformed that of the state in grade 5. And so we're very excited about the student growth when we're looking at our non-match cohorts. We're very excited about the overall growth shown here. So again, an overall growth of over 4 percentage points. But we certainly know that there's much work to be done to meet or exceed state performance. So with that being said, we will continue to follow the curriculum revision cycle. We'll continue to provide professional development and training for teachers, instructional coaches, and other staff. We will continue to utilize the look-ahead sessions to make sure that teachers are able to implement the curriculum with fidelity. We're also looking as working as a math leadership team to improve math instruction. And under the direction of our new STEM director, Noha Abdelhadi, we are looking at creating a common vision for mathematics, as well as a theory of action and an improvement framework. We will continue to strengthen our MTSS model here as it relates to mathematics. And we will also continue to provide professional development focus in areas such as K-2. We'll be looking at developing student number sense, resilience, and mathematical mindset. And 3-5, we'll begin to look at math workshop as an instructional framework or model in developing students' mathematical mindsets. And 6-8, we will continue to look at in-class differentiation to address tiered needs. And 9-12, we're at the high school, we will continue to look at math SAT strategies as well as developing students' mathematical mindsets. So moving on to English Language Arts. So here we have the overall English Language Arts performance in grades 3-8 from 2015, shown here in red, to 2016, shown in gray. This table also depicts the difference in student performance from 2015 to 2016. So the same information, just shown a different way. And again, we've observed statistically significant increases in both grades 4 and 7. We also had a fairly large increase. So in grade 4, we had an increase of 6 percentage points. In grade 7, we had an increase of 12 percentage points from 2015 to 2016, but it should also be noted that we also had a decrease of 8 percentage points in grade 8 from 2015 to 2016. So while when we averaged the performance of students across grades 3-8, we saw no statistical difference overall from 2015 to 2016. However, it should be noted that, again, Windsor was among the top performers in the Alliance cohort. And then when we looked at non-matched cohort growth, again, we did see that year-to-year growth across all grades in English Language Arts. So again, looking at how the same set of students, or roughly the same set of students, progress across grades is a gold standard. And again, we are noting that growth here in Windsor in all grade levels. So this is exceptional news, and it certainly shows the value added from Windsor Public Schools. However, it also demonstrates the need for us to raise the floor of the performance in grade 3. So the Literacy Department, under the direction of Bonnie Feynman, has established a systematic action plan and a time frame to improve aspects of the literacy curriculum and corresponding academic programming. And so this literacy improvement plan was presented to the board last year. So for example, K-2 has been completely overhauled to include Open Core, which was formally adopted last year as the foundational skills program. We now have implemented teachers' college running records with fidelity through ongoing teacher training and normative results. The K-2 literacy curriculum was also reorganized, rewritten, and will be presented to the Board of Education this December. In terms of instruction, the Literacy Department is also working to develop uniform practices and structures with respect to the literacy workshop model. We do have a draft version of the workshop document, which is now available. We are working closely with instructional coaches who are focusing on small group instruction and conferring with respect to the workshop model. And it is through an emphasis on these elements that we believe growth is most likely to occur. Additionally, we are continuing our partnerships with consultants from UConn, who have yielded specific high-level instructional practices at both the intermediate and secondary levels, and we're certainly looking to extend district-wide. And then we also have literacy professional development teams in place in strategic locations across the district, and that really creates a system of colleague-led support for all teachers. And we're very excited about that. And so the final piece will be the SAT school day. So you may be aware, but The new SAT is now administered during the school day to all students in grade 11 across the state. The SAT school day assessment, it assesses both English language arts and mathematics, and the results from the first Connecticut SAT school day show that the Windsor High School 11th graders who took the exam, about 56% are meeting or exceeding the achievement level in English language arts, which is about 10 percentage points lower than that of the state, and about 28% are meeting or exceeding the achievement standard in mathematics, which again is about 10 percentage points below that of the state. So again, these results set baseline year of data from which to measure future growth. And as you can see here, here are results in both English language arts and mathematics shown in the table. And so in summary, these standardized assessments are a measure. They provide important information on specific skills, concepts, and competencies in science, mathematics, and reading. However, it should be noted these results do not provide a comprehensive picture of the whole student or the whole school experience. And so as Dr. Cook mentioned, we will continue to support a comprehensive school system, which includes the rich world of performing arts, civic and social development, and other skills that cannot be measured by standardized assessments. And so again, as previously stated, we know that there's work to be done here in Windsor, and we will continue our curriculum work both horizontally and vertically to align what is written, taught, and assessed. We will continue to focus on differentiated and small group instruction and use data to inform professional development as well as curricular and instructional adjustments. And so if I may indulge in just one additional moment, I'd like to acknowledge the efforts of our instructional services team that were instrumental in putting this evening's presentation together. So I would be remiss if I did not thank our STEM director, Nohaf Dalhadi, our humanities director, Bonnie Hyman, Sherry Davis, who provided data support, and Maureen Ballada, who provided administrative support. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, those were a lot of numbers. So. We'll give the board members just a couple minutes, but any opening questions for Dr. Oliver on part two? Ms. Nuschetfer?
So in regards to the SBAC, I just want to make sure that I have this correct. How does the STAR assessment that the students in those grade levels that they take, does that help them be able to achieve any greater levels on the SBAC, or is it a part of like an intervention piece? I like the STAR. I just want to make sure that I'm putting my data together correctly in my head.
Absolutely. So the STAR is it's a different assessment. However, it can be used in a variety of ways. So I believe when it was first brought into the district, it was brought in to support our MTSS model. However, we are now looking to expand that for all tiers, so for all students. And one major piece for this year, we will definitely be looking at the crosswalk between the STAR assessment and the SBAC. And so there definitely is alignment there, and there definitely is the ability for the STAR to predict SBAC performance. But again, that's an area of opportunity for us and an aspiration as we begin to expand STAR to really support all tiers of our MTSS model.
Thank you. That's exactly what I was. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Mr. O'Reilly?
Yes, thank you. The tests for the CMT and the CAPT, are they getting more difficult every year? Is the bar being raised, or is it pretty consistent from one year to the next level of difficulty for the student in the exam?
That's a great question. So I did reach out to the state, and so we currently are in the same generation. So I would say at this point, the test is roughly the same. However, we recently adopted the Next Generation Science Standards. So eventually, over the next few years, we will be transitioning from the CMT and CAPT into a new science assessment. The state has yet to determine what that assessment will be and will look like. However, the expectation will be that that assessment will be more challenging because, again, the standards are more challenging and more rigorous and take a three-dimensional approach to learning science.
But for 2015, 2016, they were relatively the same.
I would say so, yes, same generation. That is correct.
Ms. Rizzo-Holmes?
Thank you. I'm just wondering if you go over the numbers again for the SAT, where we fell relative to, let's say,
oh, absolutely. So our overall scores are shown here, but with respect to the state, so the results from the first Connecticut SAT school day show that of the 11th graders across the state that took the assessment, 65% met or exceeded the achievement standard in English language arts, so that's the state data, and then 39.3% of state students met or exceeded the achievement standard in mathematics.
Okay, and where and what percentages were we?
So we here in Windsor, we were at roughly 56% for English language arts and roughly 28% for mathematics.
Okay. I don't know if, I'm not expecting that you'd have these numbers in front of you. I'm just kind of curious. I know that there were some changes made to the test score this year, and that's why obviously this is a baseline. But
absolutely.
Relative to prior years, is that consistent for us where we're falling relative to the rest of the state?
I would say so, but I would just caution us, though, again, with them being different assessments. Right. So really, I would say yes cautiously and really caution the board to look at this as a baseline year of data.
Just one other question. SBAC for both areas, there seems to be this bump in grade 7. And then also, we fell off a little bit there in grade 8. I'm just wondering if you could speak to that a little bit, if that's just going to be a difference in maybe that one cohort that was in grade 7 and moved to grade 8, if there are some individual issues there, if there's anything that you could attribute that bump in grade 7.
So definitely, looking at the data, there were some trends. So and I would actually say in grades 4 and grade 7, we definitely saw some statistically significant increases. So in grade 4, one thought might be the extra programming that was put in place. So I know the board has recently supported not only pre-K, but kindergarten. So those are some things that may have attributed to that bump. In terms of grade 7 and 8, that in particular, so again, with these being different groups of students, we did see that 7th grade being looking like a strong cohort, but then conversely, we did see some dips with that grade 8 cohort of students. So with that being said, we certainly are going to look back at our curriculum, and as stated previously, we're also looking to improve our instructional framework across the district. So looking at those two pieces, we would anticipate improvements moving forward over the next few years. We would anticipate training upwards.
Dr. Santasha, before we move on to further questions, can you just please clarify, is our grade 4 that you're presenting in this data the first cohort to be full day kindergarten?
Yes. Yeah, so that's okay. That's the first cohort that has come through having full day kindergarten in Windsor. And as Dr. Oliver mentioned, that eighth grade was a grade that we had put a lot of supports to, but did struggle. I mean, you can kind of see it from the seventh grade results provided when they were in seventh grade, now in the eighth grade, that they were a little bit below other grade levels in Windsor. So
okay.
They're now in ninth grade and we're continuing to provide additional supports.
All right. Mr. Brian Bosch, please.
I guess this is a little more of a complaint. It's not even small, but this data is very difficult. Really make heads or tails of. And one of the reasons being, a lot of these slides are completely different tests. And sometimes the same test may not even be the same test year to year. I think what Ms. Rizzo-Holmes was asking about with the state averages, that's almost the only comparator we have. It is a consistent, basis for any of these. Like, I'm right now open on our page 6, the CMT and CAP science tests. So we know, for example, the 2012 cohort for grade 8 was at 59% at or above goal. But there's really no comparator. And even if I look at that, the slide below, I'm looking at, so that same cohort would be the cohort that took the CAP test 2 years later. So we had 59% at or above grade in grade 8, but 35% at or above grade in grade 12, sorry, grade 10, that's the same cohort. I actually absolutely agree with you guys. I'd rather follow cohorts. I know it's very difficult to design a slide that shows one cohort is where we have all these different tests. But even looking for one cohort, it's really difficult to get the story, because the story looks like, you know, at least for these two slides are on the same page, that we really dip in science between grades 8 and grade 10. That may not be the case, though. Maybe everybody is showing the same results. So it's really difficult to ask questions, because it's really difficult to get the whole story from the slides.
So great points. I would be happy to put together a non-matched cohort analysis for the board, which I can forward on a later supplemental report if that would be helpful.
I think that would be really helpful. I'd love to see like how that cohort does. And to continue that example, like if we were 59% and say it was 59%, since that's really the only thing I can think of quickly that would give us any kind of comparator, and then they jump ahead to grade 10, we're 35 and state's 35, then I say, well, geez, that cohort's consistent. Or, you know, you can see kind of growth or some diminished returns on that same cohort. But,
so scale score might be one way to get at that. So again, I can forward that to the board for your review at a later date.
Awesome.
Ms. Bissell?
Oh, I'm so excited right now. So we started talking about tracking and like, you know, it's like the worst term ever, huge, but following cohorts over time, beginning last term, and it seems like maybe through the recent, I think, the developments through the data team and some of the different data points that we're tracking now, it seems like it's possible. So I just wanted to express my sincere gratitude in pulling those numbers together and painting a bigger picture for us. Because it will be really helpful to kind of see, you know, these gains that you clearly are observing, but we don't really get to see that as much because we don't have that data all the time. So thank you for that. And there was a number on here that didn't come through that I was hoping you could do something. On CMT science grade 8, I'm sorry, I don't know how many slides in, 2, 4, 6, 8 slides in. I have a page 4, but I don't know what slide number it is.
Oh, 71.
Okay, great, thank you.
Ms. Ali?
First of all, thank you for this comprehensive report. It would be interesting to look at the cohort, so I appreciate and look forward to some additional information. My question is around grade 3. Again, it's a little difficult looking at the slides, but can you tell me, it appears as though there's been a dip in the grade 3 as well. I know we talked about grade 8 a little bit, and so can you tell me, am I seeing this correct? Has there been, you know, when you look at it comparatively, can you just explain to me grade 3?
Certainly. So I don't have a number here, but if I can draw your attention to the mathematics data for the Smarter Balanced Assessment. So when you look at the mathematics performance of students in grade 3 from 2015 to 2016, we see a 1 percentage point drop there.
What page are you on?
Page 8, the bottom slide.
And so I would just say that, you know, we have to also consider what's educationally significant. So while there is a drop, I would say that that's not statistically significant. And similarly, when we look at ELA performance in grade 3, there is a decrease from 47% in 2015 to 44% in 2015 to 2016. But again, that 3 percentage points, it's not statistically significant based on the numbers of students that were tested, which were well over 200 students. So roughly, so basically performance has remained unchanged from a statistical point of view. So about the same.
Is there any data that shows that it has increased, although it's insignificant? Is there any data that shows?
So in grade 3, we have the SBAC mathematics data point. We have the same data point for English language arts. And at this point, that's it for our state assessment results.
Thank you.
So no change.
Questions?
Did you have the state's average or the did they publish all the other districts for the SAT?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So that's available on the website.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Other questions on the information, the numbers, the data? Ms. Fissell?
I'm still struggling to understand like what this is going to look like year after year. Since getting on the board, it's changed per baseline, probably like at least 3 times now. So is there, can you explain to us a little bit about what this is going to look like in the next reporting?
So the next reporting, quite frankly, I wouldn't anticipate too much change, but again, just being forward thinking over the next few years, the science assessment will change. So that CMT and CAP, which I reported on during the first segment, will certainly change. The Smarter Balanced Assessment, this is only the second administration. So again, I don't control kind of the state reporting, but based on the fact that it's the second administration, I would assume that it's going to be with us for a few more years. And similarly with the Connecticut School Day SAT, that was actually the first administration. So again, I would anticipate that being with us for a few more years. So in terms of change, I wouldn't anticipate any change for next year. And maybe over the next 3 or 4 years, we may see a change in the science assessment to better align with the next generation science standards, which were adopted in the fall of 2015.
So would it be, I know you talked a little bit about the STAR assessment and then the multi-tier system support. Should we add, I know it's kind of our discussion to have, but I'm just wondering if looking at the STAR assessments for the younger grades might be more informative to us as to whether or not we are seeing student gains, because this just doesn't show the same kind of level of detail that I feel like we've gotten in previous presentations, but it just might be the assessments, right? It's just a different type of assessment altogether.
Correct. So this is a different type of assessment altogether. So these are the results from our state assessments, yeah. So statewide assessments for all students across grades 3 through 8, 10, and 11. Here in Windsor, we do use STAR as our district-wide benchmarking assessment. I'll be happy to provide that data to the board as well when I follow up with the non-match cohort analysis.
Okay, cool. Yeah, thank you so much.
Dr. Albert, just a clarification. I recognize that the science assessment will be changing with the next generation. Are we still going to be testing in grades 5, 8, and 10?
That's a good question, and so I think they haven't really given us too much information in terms of what this new assessment will look like. At this point in time, we're still in the transition phase, so the state has actually recommended a 5-year transition plan for districts to phase in those new science standards, and then during that 5-year, or towards the end of that 5-year transition plan, there's talk of a new assessment, but there's been not too much information provided in terms of what that assessment looks like and when, the grades that will be tested.
Okay, so as far as we know, it could remain, or they could decide to just do one in a particular grade,
I think it's too early, it's too premature, I think, to make that designation, because they haven't even come out with the assessment yet, right. The pilot yet.
Okay. Any second round of questions on anything? Mr. Panos?
I assume that what you call it global interdependence as a science. I've never heard of it. Is that environmentalism?
Absolutely. Right. And absolutely.
Is there any discussion of in this plan in the years and so forth? Comprehensive exams to get a high school diploma or anything like this, or another one for eighth grade or something like that to enter high school or something like that. I mention this because this, again, Judge Mukosh made a big deal out of this,
right. Say,
claiming that getting back to the credit recovery, he kind of took quite a few pot shots at that and suggested that, there are a lot of, everybody has higher graduation rates, and he says, you're just doing these software things, they're not real courses, and then you go on and on like this. And then, he mentioned the sort of thing about comprehensive exams and all that. So I don't know if that fits in to
Yes, you mentioned the CGF ruling, which is under appeal but now by the state, so the Supreme Court will hear that, but one of the directives of that was to look at a statewide exit exam for high school, similar to what New York State has. And so we would be following that and seeing where that goes, but there, there's a potential that could be something that the state is instituting. I think that would take several years to get that, in place, but that's a potential.
And with regard to the SAT, same kind of question is, did you look at the other tests, say, for example, compared to last year versus these, similar towns or something like that, and we had significant increases, especially in language arts, was there anything comparable to that, or is it, everybody says it's a different SAT and all that sort of thing?
Exactly. So it is a very different assessment, and so I would caution the year-to-year comparison. So that's why on the slide I made a note of what the 2014-15 data was, but I didn't actually try to compare the two.
Okay.
It'll be like apples and oranges, so that's why I didn't do that comparison.
Any other questions for Dr. Oliver or Dr. Cook? I need a presentation. It appears Mr. Lockhart did not make it back from Vermont time. We hope he's safe. So moving on to agenda item number four. Just as an announcement, the board next week has a special meeting a week from tonight to take a look at our mission statement, our goals, and to move forward with the discussion around board goals, board mission statement, and where we want to head. If you have any clarifying questions on tonight's data presentation, either the first part around the state next generation accountability model or around the state assessment report received, if you would send questions to Dr. Cook by the close of business this Thursday, so that if there's additional questions on either of these two presentations, he can provide us answers a week from today at our next meeting. And I think that was the only announcement. So next week when we meet, we'll be able to discuss, again, our mission, our goals, our theories of action, and where we want to go and how to use the data that we've been presented. Did I say theories of action? It's the cold, sorry. I said mission, goals, and that's it, mission goals, that we're talking about next year, next week. Mm-hmm. Anything else? Nope, so I'll entertain a motion.
To adjourn.
I need a second.
Second
by Ms. Ali. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstention? Meeting adjourned.
We should see.